This is the fourth and last revival meeting of the series at Oak Level Christian Church, and we hope that you have and will benefit from the word that was presented to us by the contributing pastors who have brought to us this successful series of messages. Jesus came to earth for many reasons, as you have heard in the series. Tonight, Pastor Marvin Ownley will speak on the emotion Jesus felt in the loss of his friend Lazarus. And by example, we will be front row to the miracle of resurrection. It has been a pleasure to have you join us at Oak Level Christian Church, a growing farming community church in Youngsville, North Carolina. We would love to have you join us, for you will find this a loving house of the Lord. Now, let us join Pastor Ownley to listen, learn, and love.
I met Marvin years ago. Prior to coming here 10 years ago, I did an 18-week interim for a New Hope Christian Fellowship down Woodlands County outside of my hometown of Edenton. And a lot of Marvin's family, his grandfather, grandmother, were there and just came to know, love them. Later, you know, of course, Dave has been involved with the Emmaus Walk, and Marvin also with the Emmaus and Chrysalis and helped serve with that, but just came to love this guy through the years. Marvin, I believe it was a Daniel, the Bible says he was a man of an excellent spirit. And Marvin is a gentle, precious spirit. He's amazing. Our speaker last night was 36. Aaron was 30. Well, this is the baby tonight. He's 26. But hold on a minute. In addition to pastoring Stephen's Chapel Baptist Church in the Smithfield-Selma area, he's also professor of organic chemistry at Campbell University. He's a sharp young man. Very, very sharp young man. And he worried, in fact, my wife was telling him tonight, she said, don't wear yourself too thin. He said, I think the Lord's telling you to tell me that. Very sharp. Loves God. Loves God to death. And he and Lexi, both before he went to the church he is in now, were involved in Central Baptist Reverend Dunn, Brother Tom Wagner, a vibrant, dynamic, thriving independent Baptist church. And so he's got a strong conservative Bible base there, and we just love Marvin. So first of all, not Marvin only, but Marvin Montjoy, would you give that fruit basket to Lexi there? That's just some way to tell you guys we love you. We're glad you came.
Thank y'all. Thank you.
But I believe you'll be blessed tonight. We had him for dinner tonight, and just enjoy the sweet, sweet, sweet time of fellowship. So Marvin, you come on, brother, and give us what God's given to you.
Well, good evening. It's good to be with each and every one of y'all tonight. And Brother Gary, Miss Sherry, thank y'all for having us tonight. And we enjoyed dinner. That was fabulous. The fellowship was wonderful, and the food was excellent. And so we just thank the Lord for that time he gave us together. And Mr. David and Miss Rosemary, it's so good to see y'all tonight. Be back. And to be here with y'all tonight at Oak Level Christian Church. So thank y'all for the opportunity to be here and to share what the Lord's put on my heart. So I've been excited and looking forward to this since, Brother Gary, since we talked last winter, spring sometime. It's been a while ago. And been praying towards what the Lord would have me to share tonight. And he confirmed that late this summer. And I just thank him for the opportunity to come tonight. And so thank y'all for being here. And look forward to what the Lord has in store. It's exciting to see what the Lord has done already this week and how He's speaking. Just in what you prayed over me earlier, Mr. Gary, and Brother, what you prayed earlier, just how the Lord had set that in accord with what He'd already placed on my heart. So we thank y'all for being here tonight. And I just want to start with a quote this evening. My life was radically changed when I went to a men's conference about 6 months ago. And in that, the speaker was Johnny Hunt, and he started off by saying, "You don't have problems to solve, but you have choices to make." He went on in saying there that we have problems because we make poor choices. But when we get in the understanding of making biblical choices from a biblical background, we don't have problems to solve as a result of the choices we make. So tonight I want to share with you in Scripture where two sisters were faced with a choice. These two sisters were faced with the same choice, but the Bible tells us that one of these two sisters chose that which was the good part. And it would not be taken away from her. If you would turn with me in your Bible to the Gospel of Luke, chapter 10. Luke chapter 10 and verse 38. Luke chapter 10 and 9, verse 38. And while you're turning there, let's pray to the Lord. Father, we thank you for this evening. Lord, I thank you for the Spirit that you've already met with us. Lord, the promise that we are standing on your promises. 2,000 years past your resurrection, Lord, and we still stand on the promises that you gave us through your truth. Father, we thank you for how you've preserved it. Lord, we thank you for the Holy Spirit that you sent to us to speak to us, Lord, and to help us bring reckoning and understanding of your word. Father, would you open up your word tonight? Father, would your Spirit remain presence with us, Lord? And Father, speak to our hearts as only you can do. Father, may you receive the glory, the honor, and the praise for everything that is done tonight. For we ask this in your most precious and holy name. Amen.
Amen.
Luke chapter 10, beginning in verse 38 tonight. Now it came to pass as they went that he entered into a certain village, and a certain woman named Martha received him into her house. And she had a sister called Mary, which also sat at Jesus' feet and heard his word. But Martha was cumbered about with much serving and came to him and said, Lord, dost thou know not care that my sister hath left me to serve alone? Bid her therefore that she help me. And Jesus answered and said unto her, Martha, Martha, thou art careful and troubled about many things. But one thing is needful, and Mary hath chosen that good part which shall not be taken from her. Here we find in Luke's gospel, we find where this is taking place in the village of Bethany. And we'll see later tonight in Scripture, in John chapter 11, tells us that this is about 2 miles out from Jerusalem. We're on the outskirts of the holy city, on the eastern slope of the Mount of Olives. But what do we find in verse 39 in our text tonight? And she had a sister called Mary, which also sat at Jesus' feet and heard his word. Where's the proper place for a disciple? A disciple of Christ, where's the proper place that we find a disciple? Is nowhere else but at Jesus' feet. And we see here that Mary, the Bible tells us later that she chose the good part. She wasn't cumbered about much serving and doing, but she was simply found at the feet of Jesus. And I want to thank the Lord for servants that are found at His feet. I'm looking at four of them tonight, and I would not be standing here before you tonight if these four individuals here and many more had not invested in my life in the way they had. But for the example that they also had, when I was looking at an example of someone, a godly man or woman, that I found them at Jesus' feet. And I think that each and every one of you have certain people and individuals you look to in your life, and you have found them as an example before you at Jesus' feet. The proper and only true place for a disciple. Unlike the culture in this day that would have said that only a man could sit under the teaching of a professor or teacher, we find here that the Messiah was teaching. She was never rebuked, but she was welcome because she was worshiping genuinely the Messiah. But what do we find as the story goes on in verse 40? But Martha was cumbered about much serving and came to him and said, Lord, dost thou not know that my sister hath left me to serve alone? Bid her, therefore, that she help me. Can you imagine what the scene would have looked like in that kitchen? If that one that was in charge of all the cooking went tearing out to the guest that was there and said, would you tell my sister to come in here and help? You know, I can understand this because I grew up, I've got a younger sister, and my mama loves to cook. And I like to eat, so if you like to eat, you got to learn how to cook a little bit if you want to eat. And so I was always enjoyed when I was able to be in the kitchen with my mama cooking, but my sister didn't like to be told what to do, so she wasn't in there as much as I was. And when we would have a lot of people come over, sometimes mama, it was a lot of stress. I can't imagine. I've never entertained a group like she has. I couldn't imagine the stress she was under, but she'd start barking those orders a little bit, and I would just, you know, learn how to manage my time a little bit better. So one day I could do that. But I can't imagine what it would have looked like in that kitchen with Martha running around. And where was her head helper? Her sister. That was her own flesh and blood there. And she went and looked, and she was sitting down. And she went running to this guest. It was Jesus, the Messiah, the Christ, the Chosen One. And he said, Mary has chosen the better, and it will not be taken away from her. What do you think Martha missed out on that night in that house? She was so distracted making sure that the fried chicken and biscuits and the mashed potatoes and gravy and everything was just perfect and putting the perfect touches on that she never got the chance to worship And we'll see in just a little while how that genuine worship at Jesus' feet prepared Mary for a tragedy that she was soon going to face in her life. But let's think about that in our context in today. What do we miss out on in life because of the daily distraction? The simple opportunities we have to come and sit at Jesus' feet. What do we miss out on because we're distracted, encumbered about money? I know I struggle with that from time to time. Got this to do, that to do. I'm a list person. And so the more I write out, the more I can mark off, the better a day has been. And Lexi will be the first one to tell you, I can tell you how good my day's been by how much I've got accomplished. And she can say, have you had a good day? And I say, I got this done, that done, the other done. She said, do you understand you measure every day by productivity? And I was like, thank you for letting me understand that. Yes, you're right, I do. But what do we miss out, even in church? The busyness in the work of church that we miss out on the genuine worship and opportunity to come and sit at Jesus' feet. What do we find in verse 41? And Jesus answered and said unto her, Martha, Martha, thou art troubled about many things, but one thing is needful, and Mary hath chosen that good part which shall not come to pass. You know, we think there are many good parts in life. You know, we need to do this, we need to be here in order we can make this appearance. But Jesus makes it very clear right here in the gospel that there's only one thing in life that's needed. And Mary, in that moment, chose the good part. What a promise. That if we choose the genuine opportunity to sit and worship under the teaching and worship at Jesus' feet, that everything else will take care of itself. When our heart's right and in accord with Him, life just goes a little bit better. Can anybody in here tonight be a witness to that? How when we put Jesus first in everything that we do. Lexi shared with me last week. I was a little down and beaten. And she said, Marvin, you need to remember that the joy of the Lord is your strength. She said, you need to remember, you can't run this on your own strength. She said, but that verse says, the joy of the Lord is your strength. When there's no joy in your life, you got to remember, it's from the Spirit and from the Lord that the joy comes. The joy of the Lord is your strength. Are you joyful tonight? Or are you trying to run the race on your own? Because the only way we can endure the battle before us is with the joy of the Lord. Turn with me over to John chapter 11 tonight. John chapter 11, and we find here again the story of Mary and Martha. And while you're turning to John chapter 11, I want to set a little background on what we find here. We know that in John's Gospels there are 7 miracles that Jesus performed. The first started when He was in Canaan and turned the water into wine. Miracle number 6 was in chapter 9 when He healed the blind man. But the last miracle that we see that Jesus performed in this gospel happens right here in chapter 11. It was the most powerful and yet moving miracle that Jesus did in John's gospel. And we see when this story comes to a close, it resulted immediately and then conspiring on how they would betray Jesus. As the story opens, we find the scene and the details surrounding of a very familiar character by the name of Lazarus. He had 2 sisters that are Mary and Martha that we've already heard about tonight, and they sent word out in verse 11 that to Jesus that his friend was sick. And the first response that Jesus gave was that he was not going to go at that very moment, but he was going to wait, and he waited 2 days because the Bible goes on to tell us that he wanted to wait in order that the glory for the Lord would be shown in the midst of this miracle and what was about to happen. And we see that in verse 15 of chapter 11, he knew that what was about to happen would change the lives of the 12 men that would follow him to the cross. Those 12 men that he had invested in as disciples, their faith was about to be shaken in such a miraculous way by what they were about to find. Let's pick up with this story tonight in verse 17 of chapter 11. Then when Jesus came, he found that they had laid him in the grave 4 days earlier. Now Bethany was nigh to Jerusalem, about 15 furlongs off. And many of the Jews came to Martha and Mary to comfort them concerning their brother. Then Martha, as soon as she heard that Jesus was coming, went and met him. But Mary sat still in the house. Then said Martha unto Jesus, Lord, if thou hadst been here, my brother had not died. But I know that even now, whatsoever you will ask of God, God will give it to thee. Jesus saith unto her, thy brother shall arise again. Martha saith unto him, I know that he shall rise again in the resurrection in the last day. Jesus said unto her, I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth in me, though if he were dead, yet shall he live. And whosoever liveth and believeth in me shall never die. Believest thou this? She said unto him, Yes, Lord, I believe thou art the Christ, the Son of God, which should come unto the world. And when he said so, she went her way and called Mary her sister secretly, saying, The Master is come and calleth for thee. Verse 29. As soon as she heard that, she arose quickly and came unto him. Now Jesus had not yet come into the town, but was in the place where Martha met him. The Jews then which were with her in the house saw and comforted her. When they saw Mary, that she rose up hastily and went out, followed her, saying, She goeth unto the grave to weep there. Jesus arrives in Bethany, and he finds the scene of his friend. The Bible tells us Lazarus was his friend, and that he had already been dead 4 days. We'll see in just a minute that the smell from his death and his decomposing body was already taken over at the tomb. But Jesus arrives there in verse 17, and it was at this point that the reality had set in for the disciples. The family had already come to terms with the death of their brother and loved one, but the disciples, he had referenced it earlier as he was sleeping, and it wouldn't end unto death. But here in verse 17, it sets in, Lazarus is dead. Can you imagine the expression that would have been on these disciples' faces when they arrived, when they saw the family grieving, and their brother had already been laid in the tomb? Verse 21 tells us that as soon as Martha received word that Jesus was there, she went out and met him along as he was making his way unto the village. Martha was the one that when Jesus was in their house earlier, she was the one that was distracted. She hadn't spent any time with him. And then yet when she receives word, Mary, the one that had worshipped at his feet, had stayed behind at the house mourning with friends. But Martha, the Bible tells us, was the one that went out. When she comes up to Jesus, her response is much like ours it often is in times of difficulty and trouble. If you would have only come earlier, this wouldn't have ended in my brother's death. Jesus responds to her, and then she realizes, Yes, Lord, you are the Christ, and I believe in the resurrection. And she makes that clear. But what do we find in verse 29? It took place. Going back to 28 to set the background. And when she had said so, she went her way and called Mary her sister, saying, The Master has come and called for Jesus come up on scene and he met the sister that had prepared that meal for him. He spoke to her and they exchanged and he had promised her that he was the Christ. But he said to her, Where is your sister? That one that worshipped at my feet. Martha sent out word for Mary immediately. And verse 29 says, And as soon as she heard that, she arose quickly and came unto him. There was no hesitation in Mary's life when Jesus went calling for her. As soon as she received word that Jesus was in town and he wanted to see her and see her personally, she tore through that door at their house. And the Bible says that everyone that was there mourning with her came along behind her. And we'll get there in just a minute. But how many times in our life when Jesus comes calling and knocking on the door, do we hesitate and put it off and wait to do what the Lord has called us to do? But here we see Mary tore through the door and went running to Jesus. Remember back to what we saw in Luke chapter 10. Jesus there responded to Martha when she was complaining about her sister, and he said, She hath chosen the good part, and it shall not be taken away from her. Mary had spent her time at Jesus' feet worshiping Him when she had the opportunity. And when opposition and trial and difficulty came, she was mourning with her friends. But when the Savior went calling out to her, she was ready to come running. She had done some preparation. As Brother Ricky Bishop put it in his book, she was preparing for the storms of life. And she was prepared. And I don't know tonight if you find yourself on the mountain or you might be in the valley or on somewhere in between. But the time to prepare for the difficult time to come is now. Because Mary was prepared in advance for when this time of mourning came for her brother. And when Jesus called unto her, she did not hesitate. Aren't you glad that Jesus meets us where we are?
Yes.
He met Mary right where she was in the midst of her mourning. And he called out to her and she came running. And there he met Mary. Don't forget the crowd that followed her. We'll get back to that in just a minute. Verse 32. Then when Mary was come where Jesus was and saw him, she fell down at his feet, saying unto him, Lord, if thou hadst been here, My brother had not died. Mary and Martha had almost the same response as soon as they met Jesus. When Jesus therefore saw her weeping, and the Jews also weeping, which came with her, he groaned into the spirit and was troubled, and said, "Where have ye laid him?" They said unto him, "Lord, come and see." Verse 35, the shortest passage in all the Bible. Jesus wept. Then said the Jews, "Behold, how he loved him." And some of them said, "Could not this man, which opened the eyes of the blind, have caused that even this man should not have died?" Again, this is the second time we see Mary at Jesus' feet. Verse 32 tells us, as soon as she arrived, the first thing she did, she fell at his feet and worshiped Jesus. Verse 33 tells us that Jesus, however, was also troubled. When he saw Mary come, and he saw how broken she was and how mourning she was, it had set in for her. Her brother had been dead 4 days and been laid in the tomb. And here she comes, and Jesus sees how distraught she was in mourning. And all these people, family and friends that gathered together with her, they were following behind her, and they too were mourning with her. And she came and fell at his feet. And the Bible says that he was troubled in verse 33. Jesus wanted to know where he laid him. Verse 35, the shortest passage in all of Scripture, simply says, Jesus wept. You know what that tells me? That tells me that Jesus relates to me in my personal life in every aspect of it. We see more clearly here the humanity of Jesus than anywhere else in the Bible, because he tells us what? That this man was a friend of the bridegroom. He was a friend of Christ, the Messiah, the one that was about to go to the cross and give his life so that our sins could be forgiven. And it says that this friend of his caused him to break down and weep. All those disciples that were gathered around him, the multitude that came with Mary, they all said in verse 36, "Behold, how he loved him." Jesus can relate to you wherever you are tonight. You might be broken and mourning or walking through a difficult and a trying time, but I want you to see in this text tonight that Jesus understands the mourning and the difficult times in our life. Don't ever think in the midst of those dark days in the valley that the presence of the Lord is not there, because here we see that Jesus too was cut to the core as he broke and wept over the passing of his friend. Pick up in verse 38. Jesus therefore, again groaning in himself, cometh to the grave. It was a cave, and a stone lay upon it. Jesus said, "Take ye away the stone." Martha, the sister of him that was hurt, "By this time he stinketh, for he hath been dead 4 days. Jesus saith unto her, "Said I not unto thee that if thou wouldst believe, thou shouldst see the glory of God?" Then they took away the stone from the place where the dead was laid. And Jesus lifted up his eyes and said, "Father, I thank thee that thou hast heard me, and I knew that thou hearest me always. But because of the people which stand by, I said it that they might believe that thou hast sent me." And when he thus had spoken this, he cried out in a loud voice, "Lazarus, come forth." And he that was dead came forth, bound hand and foot with grave clothes, and his face was bound about with a napkin. Jesus saith unto him, "Loose him and let him go." When they arrive on scene at this tomb, and they begin to make preparations to roll the stone away, the sister says, "Lord, I want to make sure you know that it's clicked with you just like it has us. As soon as this stone's unsealed and it's rolled away, we're going to smell my brother's decomposing body." And Jesus looks at her and says, "Mary, don't worry about that. Just trust me and wait and see." The stone was rolled away, and there we see that Jesus called upon the Father in prayer in verse 42. And he says right here in Scripture, "And I knew that thou hearest me always." But he went on to say, "I pray this right now because of those that are in my midst." Those disciples that went along with him. Thomas earlier in John 11 said, "Father, is this too going to end in our death?" And they went together. He prayed the prayer because he knew. Jesus came anticipating. Did you come tonight anticipating what the Spirit was going to do tonight? Did you come tonight anticipating the move of God? Or are you just sitting here tonight in church? Did you come expecting to meet with Jesus tonight? I was humbled at the opportunity, and I came tonight anticipating what the Lord was going to do. But we find the people, they came here, and they were doubting. They were questioning what was about to happen. But Jesus pointed all the glory, the honor, and the praise to the Father as he prayed. And he said, "Lord, I'm praying because of you. I want the people around me to see what you're about to do through your servant." And then The disciples witnessed that prayer. The family did, and the friends. And then we see Lazarus came forth. Still bound by the grave clothes. Can you imagine the linen cloths, the strips that would have been falling off his body as he began walking forth? A man that his flesh just instants before was decomposing. But here he comes walking out and strips of linen cloth are falling off. There's a napkin that falls off his face. Jesus simply says, free him from the cloth and let him go. I find it interesting in the text that that's all we get about Lazarus. His life was gone. He was raised from the dead. And there was no response that we get from Lazarus at the grave. But you know what? This miracle number 7 and every miracle that Jesus did, it wasn't about the individual that received the miracle. And any miracle that you've been a part of, a witness in your life, it's not about you, your family member, friend. It's about the glory that goes to the Father and the one that did it through Him. And we find that tonight in this same story. It wasn't about Lazarus. He was the one that was just chosen to testify and appoint to the power that had been given to the Son through the Father. And not a word is mentioned more about Lazarus. But what do you find in verse 45? Then many of the Jews which came to Mary and had seen the things which Jesus did, believed on Him. Here we are, one of the best friends of Jesus, the Bible tells us, Lazarus. He raises him from the dead in the final miracle in this gospel. And what happened? But those family and friends that had gathered around with that family during their difficult time, loving on them as best they knew how, they didn't know that they were going to meet Jesus that day. They were just following one that had pointed them and they had seen worshiping at Jesus' feet. And so they followed Mary out of that house because they loved her. They wanted to be there to support her. And they followed her to Jesus. And then together they caravaned and convoyed along, walking together to that tomb until when Jesus performed this miracle. And as a result of raising one of his best friends from the dead, we know that many people were saved that day because of the power that was given to the Son through the Father. Can you imagine what that would be like to see Lazarus come tearing forth? And it wasn't about him, but the Father to instantly glorify himself by the saving those people that had no faith in Christ at that point. Those are two times that we see Mary at Jesus' feet. And the final time that we find her there is in John chapter 12. Turn on with me to the next chapter in this gospel. John the 12th chapter, beginning in verse 1. Then Jesus, 6 days before the Passover, came to Bethany, where Lazarus was, which had been dead. So this is after the miracle has been done, whom he raised from the dead. There they made him a supper. He got to eat with them several times. And Martha served, but Lazarus was one of them that sat at the table with him. Then took Mary a pound of ointment of spikenard, very costly, and anointed the feet of Jesus and wiped his feet with her hair. And the house was filled with the odor of the ointment. Then saith of his disciples, Judas Iscariot, Simon's son, which would betray him, why was not the ointment sold for 300 pence and given to the poor? This he said not that he cared for the poor, but because he was a thief and had the bag and bare that was put therein. Then said Jesus, let her alone. Against the day of my burying hath she kept this. For the poor you have with you always, but me you will not always have. The only thing that took place in between Lazarus being raised from the dead and Mary anointing Jesus' feet was the conspiracy that took place in the Bible of how they were going to hand Jesus over. Most powerful miracle we see Jesus perform in John's gospel, the raising of one of his best friends from the grave, results in the people automatically plotting on how they're going to hand him over. And then we see this faithful sister on scene again. At a final appearance, she is once again worshiped at Jesus' feet. The Bible tells us that she took a very costly and expensive ointment and she poured it upon his feet and she took her very hair and she wiped his feet with him. And then Judas, the one that was going to betray Jesus for that little bit of silver by a kiss, said, why would she not sell this and give the money to the poor? He was the keeper of the bag. But Mark's gospel tells us that this good work which this woman has done will not be forgotten. So my question for you tonight, have you chose the good part? Life is quick to tell us all that there are many things in life that we can do. There are a lot of things that we need to devote our time to. If we're going to have a good and meaningful and a righteous life, there's a lot of different directions we have to go. That's what the world's going to fill our mind with. We've got to be here, we've got to be there, we've got to be in this organization and that organization. But the Bible makes it clear that none of that even matters. There's only one thing that matters. Luke chapter 10. And Mary chose the good part. But for me, the comfort in that is wasn't that she only chose the good part, and it would not be taken away from her. So my question for you tonight, one, have you chose the good part? Have you chosen the opportunity to sit, to come, and to worship at Jesus' feet? In the good times and in the bad. And use those good times as Mary did to prepare for what was coming next. You know, oftentimes we don't realize, we don't know what's coming the next day. We don't know what we're going to face tonight in our lives. But isn't it amazing to look back over the course of our life, wherever you may be today, and look back in your life and you can see how Jesus used times to prepare you for what was to come yet in your life. And how He used this time that Mary had where Jesus was in her very home. And you know, it would have been a very tempting choice to make. I want to just have the opportunity to prepare His meal. But instead, she chose something even better than that. And it was to worship and to sit under His teaching as He sat there and explained the gospel. I know the Lord honored that when He saw that in Mary, because that was what sent her directly running to Him as soon as the Lord came calling. And then all those friends that she had had the opportunity to influence and sit under her, they followed her because she was following Christ. There at the grave of a brother as He came walking out, they believed on Him. So tonight, I don't know where you are, what the difficulty is, or what you're walking through in life. I want you to know that only one thing in life is needed, and that's the good part. Have you accepted Jesus as your Lord and Savior? Maybe tonight you said, yes, Marvin, I have. That's why I'm here tonight. I'm here. Revival. I'm here to be revived. Are you cumbered about much serving? Much busyness in life because we haven't made priority for the one thing that is important and urgent in our life. I want to close tonight with telling you a simple story. It's a story of a little preschool girl. And it was after recess that this little girl came walking out. She walked out of the bathroom. She sat back down at the table with all the rest of her classmates as they were preparing to have their snack before their parents would come and pick them up from school. The teacher looked and noticed that the little girl was smelling her hands. And very discreetly, the teacher got the student to the side and said, come here. And she noticed again the little girl that she was sniffing her hands. The teacher, in the kindest way possible, said softly to the student, do we need to wash our hands? No. She shook her head no. And she said, are you sure? She said, yes. What do you smell on your hand? The teacher asked her. She said, it smells like you, and you love me. This little girl simply replied, teacher, it smells like you, and you love me. Because this teacher had spent time and invested in her life and showed her love in the most simple way that a child could understand. Tonight, I ask you, what do your hands smell like? Are they cumbered about much serving and busyness in life, much like Martha's were in this text? Or do they smell like Mary's? Does it smell like the genuine worship that comes to us as we sit at Jesus' feet? Would you pray with me tonight? Father, we thank You for the opportunity You've given us to gather tonight in Your house. And Lord, we just thank You for times when You're able to get the body together, Lord. Father, for an intentional purpose of reviving our hearts and our lives for You, Lord. Father, and I ask that You would be glorified tonight from every song, the song that was sung earlier this evening. Lord, the prayers that have been lifted up. Father, Your Word has been opened, Lord. Father, I ask anything You've said through me, Lord, that You've said it. And Father, would You just allow the hearts of the people to be moved and be touched tonight, Lord, as You see fit. Father, would You remind us that only one thing is needed, and that we need to choose that which is the good part. Lord, would You have Your way tonight? For us in Your most precious and holy name we pray.
The news came to Jesus. Please come fast. Lazarus is sick, and without Your help, he will not last. Mary and Martha watched their brother die. They waited for Jesus. He did not come, and they wondered why. The death watch was over, buried 4 days. Somebody said, He'll soon be here, the Lord's on His way. Martha ran to Him, and then she cried, Lord, if You had been here, You could have healed him. He'd still be alive. But You're 4 days late, and all hope is gone. Lord, we don't understand why You've waited so long. Still the same.